Today, I have the great pleasure of interviewing mountaineer and writer Joe Simpson. I'm sure the majority of the people watching this interview have read at least one of his books, or at least have seen the movie Touching the Void. If not, I suggest you do so. He is certainly the man with the strongest survivor instinct I've ever met. Joe is here in Trento to present the movie based on another of his books, The Beckoning Silence, which tells the story of one of mountaineering's most epic tragedy. Hello, Joe Simpson, and welcome.
Thank you.
Now, you haven't climbed for nearly 3 years. I'd like to know what exactly happened to you 3 years ago, because in Peru, I mean, you almost died, and that didn't stop you. What stopped you 3 years ago?
Well, it's probably a cumulative effect of various accidents that I've had. You know, basically my...
Well, you're kind of accident prone.
Well, survival
little.
Prone, probably. You know,
that's what I said
I mean,
before.
But the thing is that it's almost like my body's now cashing the checks I wrote when I was 20. So I have a very bad fracture in my knee and in this ankle. And then this ankle is very badly damaged.
Yeah.
Very, very bad. And so I have arthritis in the legs. And so to some extent, I can still rock climb and really ice climb to quite a high standard. But to go mountaineering, and it's coming downhill. It's my legs are finished, you know.
Yeah.
And it's no, so I don't want to do it now because it's painful. And so that was partly the reason. And also, I've sort of done everything I can do. I can't climb at the standard I used to climb, and many of my friends are either not climbing anymore or they're dead. And so I just decided it's time to stop climbing. So.
Yeah.
Stop mountaineering anyway.
Stop mountaineering, but you're still doing it. You're still in the mountains doing some things.
Yeah.
Your book, The Beckoning Silence, and the movie talk about the 1936 tragedy of Tony Kurtz and his three climbing companions on the north face of the Eiger. A story you said many times that you read when you were quite young, similar thing happened to you in Peru. You said you should have died as Kurtz did, yet you did not. But in a way, you kind of quit mountaineering, so a great part of you has, in a way, died. It seems like The Beckoning Silence is like a real come full circle farewell to the way you lived the first part of your life.
Yeah, this was a bit valedictory, I suppose. I mean, in a way, I've written six books, but three of the books are like a trilogy. It's like, it starts with Touching the Void. Mm. But all you know in Touching the Void is just Simon and me and what happens, this story. And then the next book is This Game of Ghosts, and this is about where Simon and I and my generation of climbers came from and what we were trying to do. And really, that book is about the question of why would you, if you're doing something that is your passion, it's your love, and it's the life-enhancing thing you do, and yet it's killing friends of yours, you know. And
it's over, the paradox.
There's a paradox.
Yeah.
There is an inherent paradox, you know, that you love doing it, and yet, you know, maybe one friend every year is dying. That's a strange. Why would you carry on doing it? And then the last book, The Beckoning Silence. I mean, the book, The Beckoning Silence, is not only about the Tony Kurtz story.
Yes,
it's about me getting to the end of this, where I'm thinking, I have to stop now. My legs are not up to it. I don't want to carry on doing this. And then I decided with my friend Ray Delaney that we would go and climb the 38 route on the Eiger. Because to us, the Eiger was a seminal mountain. It was
for many,
particularly my generation. It's an extraordinary mountain. It's an extraordinary mountain in many ways. Just physically, if you stand under the North Face, it just comes straight out of a meadow.
It's overwhelming.
It's incredible. I've seen amazing mountains all over the world, and the Eiger is just really, you just go, Jesus. But then it's also, it's got all these incredible stories and tragedies and histories that even before you start climbing this thing, you're thinking, God almighty, it's like stepping into history. And we wanted to just go back and do this climb. We wanted to, it's almost like paying homage to all the people that you knew who climbed it in the past. And
and
we tried to do this in 2000, and very sadly there was a big storm and some people were killed in front of us, actually. And we tried it for the next two or three years, and we still haven't climbed it, actually.